Welcome to Manifest, hosted by international evangelist, teacher, and author Perry Stone. Enjoy unique insight into prophetic and practical truth. It's time to feast on fresh manna, so get ready to be blessed and encouraged. And now, here is your host and teacher, Perry Stone.
In the next few moments, I want to share with you what I consider to be one of the great mysteries of the Bible that can now be understood. If you're a person that loves Hebraic mysteries, I believe you're going to enjoy today's program. Now, I'm here with our group. This is a double tour. This is our first tour group, which has come with many of our partners. We got Karen Wheat and Judy Jacobs with us, two of our best friends in all the world. But we're in the Garden of Gethsemane. To my knowledge, in the 13-year history of Manifest, I have never done a teaching from the Garden of Gethsemane. Just so that you will know, this is the garden in John 18 where Jesus would come often to pray, and it's where they had him arrested, but afterwards he stood trial, and then the crucifixion soon followed. But I want to take you on a journey for the next few moments, because there's a scripture in Genesis 3:15 that says this: I will put enmity between you and the woman, between her seed and thy seed. It shall bruise thy head, thou shalt bruise his heel. Now, in this verse of scripture, it talks about the seed of the serpent. There's been a lot of controversy over the years as to what God meant when he said in the garden, the seed of the serpent and the woman would have enmity with one another. Now, one of the teachings that emerged, and honestly, I cannot believe this teaching, I do not believe this teaching, but it has existed, it's all over the internet, is that somehow Eve had relations with the actual serpent and somehow produced the seed of Cain, who was called in the New Testament that wicked one. And that's just a very elaborate teaching that to me has no basis whatsoever. And I know sometimes when I say something, people are going to send me a 20-page article trying to convince me. But on that particular one, don't bother doing that, because I'm just telling you that's not what it's talking about there. I will tell you what I do believe, however, it's talking about. In the book of Genesis chapter 6, it tells us that there were giants in the earth in those days, and it says that the giants were a product of the sons of God coming into the daughters of men, and it produced a race of giants known as the men of renown. Now, I'm going to abbreviate this because it's a very complicated teaching, but the early fathers, I know some of the what we call extra-biblical books as well, Jewish rabbis, Josephus, all of the people before the 4th century A.D., that talked about who were the giants that existed on earth in the time of the flood and the time shortly after the flood, all of them believed that God sent angels down to earth. And when God sent these angels down to earth, they were to teach, they took on human bodies and were to teach men righteousness. They were to teach them how to walk with God and do the right thing. However, the history reveals that they became enamored with the daughters of men, and they were able to go into the women, or the daughters of men, the young virgins, and produce a race of giants. Now, that brings up some theological complications. Number one, it says, in heaven men are neither married nor given in marriage. And someone says, angels are sexless. Well, consider this, though. Consider this, how that Jesus Christ, who was with God, took upon himself a human body and was capable of sinning. He did not sin, but he could commit any sin that any human could commit in a human body. So we're not talking about angels in their eternal state. Absolutely. There's no relations involved with angels who are spirits, because spirits can't produce spirits. But when they took upon themselves the form of flesh, and again, the writings of the early fathers, the writings of Jewish historians and Jewish rabbis believed that these giants, Goliath, for an example, was the offspring of fallen angels coming into the daughters of men. Now, in 2 Peter and also the book of Jude, it says, the angels that kept not their first estate, he is now bound in chains of darkness. Peter says they're bound in hell. The Greek word is Tartarus, which is a Greek word for the lowest compartment under the earth, or the lowest hell. So these angels that committed these crimes against humanity produced a race of giants. When the flood came, if you'll go to Genesis 6, one of the reasons the flood came was to destroy this corrupt race of giants. The early fathers said that the Greeks built up this huge mythology which was all fabricated based on the truth that these giants actually existed and were called demagogues. As a matter of fact, in ancient Sumeria, which is the territory of Iraq, 5,500 years ago, someone put out what's called cuneiform tablets. And it talks about how a planet that was millions of years old, that the gods came from that planet to Earth and were worshiped among the people. This, I believe, were the fallen angels that Jude and also Peter talk about. Now, after the flood, there was another race of giants, and the Bible gives you the name of five of them: Goliath, Lami, Ishbibenoth, Saph, and a giant from Gath here in Israel that had six fingers on each hand and six toes on each feet. Now, these particular giants were believed to be the last of the race of the giants. Now, I'm saying that for a reason. These giants were the seed of the serpent that had enmity with the woman, a clash between the woman and the seed of the serpent. And so, in other words, I don't normally bring this out when I teach on this, because we did a teaching years ago called Fallen Angels, Giants, and the Mystery of Evil Spirits. Demon spirits or evil spirits in your Bible show up in the book of Judges for the first time by name. An evil spirit came against Abimelech. And then you find out how that as you come along in the New Testament, you see a lot of demonic activity. 200 years before the birth of Christ, the rabbinical teaching was this, that when the giants died, because they were the offspring of a fallen being, a fallen angel, and a woman, that when the spirit left their bodies, they became the demons. So in other words, 200 years before Christ, the idea of a demon was not a fallen angel or not a disembodied spirit, as some have taught, from the pre-Adamic world, a world that existed before Adam that was destroyed, and the spirits of those people have roamed the earth and become demons. But yet they were the spirits of the giants that when the giant was slain would come out of its body. So God destroyed an entire race of giants, but after the flood, more of them showed up. Now, the Jewish teaching is this, that on Mount Hermon in northern Israel, God sent 200 angels down to teach again men righteousness. Now, remember, this is before the Torah. This is before any written word from God. This is before God ever revealed anything to Moses about His word and truth. These, again, corrupted themselves with the daughters of men. Eventually, God took these angels off of the planet. Again, these were called demagogues. They produced a race of giants that were called demagogues, part human and part God. This, ladies and gentlemen, is not just within biblical history. It's not just in early fathers' history. This is in tablets that have been discovered in especially the area of Iraq, ancient Ur of Chaldea, ancient Samaria, where they talk about the gods who came down to live among men. It's a very unusual mystery. Now, the reason I'm sharing that with you is to talk about one of these giants, in particular named Goliath. Goliath is mentioned in 1 Samuel chapter 17. Now, in 1 Samuel chapter 17, it gives you the size of Goliath. If you were to break it down to the size of a cubit, which averages 18 inches in the Hebrew form and 24 inches in the Egyptian form, Goliath was slightly over 10 feet tall. Now imagine that. He's a very tall man, very tall person, and he's taunting Israel. All of a sudden, a young boy by the name of David comes along and takes a stone and decks Goliath and kills him. And then he does something. He takes the sword and cuts his head off. I don't have time to share with you, but you can tell it by the text of 1 Samuel that Goliath was not killed by the stone, he was stunned. And the reason that David took Goliath's own sword to cut his head off is because he knew that the giant might arouse and come back to life, so he took the sword and cut the head of the giant off. Now, something very weird happened. I had read the Bible for 32 years before I realized that this was actually in the Scripture. Now, here's what I want to share with you. When Goliath was slain and David cut his head off, listen to what the Bible said. David took the head of the Philistine and brought it to Jerusalem, but he put the giant's armor in his tent. Now, I want to ask a question. We have a live audience here. Why would David kill Goliath in the Valley of Elah, which is, you know, depending on how, if you drive it or fly like a bird, let's say 18 miles away, 20 miles away, why would he take that head and drag it to this city, all the way to the city of Jerusalem? Secondly, what do you do with the head of a giant? The only thing you do is not put it on a display, you bury it somewhere. Now, what do you think the place would be called where the head of Goliath, a giant that represented the seed of the serpent, what do you think that place would be called? Well, let's go ahead in time and see where the crucifixion of Jesus is taking place. When Jesus is crucified, four gospel writers all talk about the crucifixion. And in the issue of the crucifixion, they give a very interesting statement. They said that Jesus was crucified on a hill that in Latin is called Calvary, Calvaria, or in Hebrew is called Golgotha. And it's called Golgotha because it is called, here's the quote, the hill of the skull. Now, the question has always been for centuries, why was it named the hill of the skull? One early church father, Origen, made this statement that he believed it was named because that's where Adam's skull was buried. Now, there's a tradition, and a man reemerged that tradition many years later, and they never found evidence on what this particular man said, and I won't go into detail about that, but they never found the evidence. But he came up with the story that he had dug underneath Golgotha and found a rock that had the original blood of Jesus on it. Of course, they dug the garden tomb up, never found anything that what he said, and again, that's another issue. But that idea, that concept of the Ark of the Covenant being hidden, or actually, in the early church father's statement of Jesus being crucified and the blood coming down and touching Adam's skull was a tradition. It was never based on scripture. It was never based on any evidence. So some said the hill of the skull is where Adam's skull was buried. That, and here's the Jewish tradition, that when Noah got on the ark, they took the skull of Adam with them. And after the flood, Shem, who was Melchizedek, came here and buried Adam's skull somewhere in Jerusalem. Let me make it clear, no biblical evidence for that, but that was handed down by what's called the oral tradition among Jewish rabbis and Jews over the centuries. But let's go back to Goliath for a moment. Goliath, according to your Bible, is called Goliath from Gath. Now, if you take his name Goliath from Gath, you can take Gol and Gatha, and you have the formation of the word Goliath, Goliath, Gola, Goliath, Goliath from Gath. Now look at this, Golgotha, Golgotha. It's very similar wording there. Now this is what I personally believe. I believe that David took this, the head of Goliath, which represented the seed of the serpent, and I believe he buried that head in the city of Jerusalem, and that became known as the Hill of the Skull. And here's the reason why. Because he represented, number one, the seed of the serpent. Number two, he represented the enemies of Israel. And number three, he represented the epitome of evil that Satan had tried to produce on the earth through the offspring of fallen angels and the daughters of men. So watch this. When Jesus is crucified, the prophecy was, I'll put enmity between thee and the woman, between her seed and thy seed. It'll bruise thy head. It will bruise thy head, the head of the serpent. Thou shalt bruise his heel. When Jesus is being crucified on Golgotha, he's on the hill of the skull. If the theory I suggest is correct, the skull of Goliath was buried somewhere under there, representing the seed of the serpent, representing the powers of the enemy that had brought corruption and even brought the flood judgment upon the earth, the giants that had kept the Israelites out of the promised land, the giant named Goliath that had caused fear in the Hebrew army where they did not want to fight. But when Jesus' blood came out of his body, and it poured down into the soil of that hill called Golgotha. If Goliath's head was buried there, it fulfilled Genesis 3:15. The heel of Jesus was bruised because when they crucified a man, we have drawings of this, they now say that they put the nail not in the top part as traditionally thought, but in the heel. The nail was placed through the heel and the tree was in the middle and there was a nail on the left heel and a nail on the right heel. The heel of Jesus was completely bruised. But more than that, the seed of the serpent's head was completely crushed. And that's what Genesis 3:15 says. It's a prediction about the defeat of the enemy and the defeat of Satan. And so that happened right here in the city of Jerusalem. Now, let me suggest something to you. Should the rabbinical interpretation of where demons came from, that they actually were the spirits of the giants that died. You know, the Bible says that the dead have no resurrection, but that word dead is not the normal word for dead. It's the word rephaim in Hebrew. The Hebrew Bible says the rephaim have no resurrection. By the way, the rephaim is a Hebrew name for a race of the giants that existed. So it's like saying the giants have no resurrection. Why would they have no resurrection? Because once they died, their bodies went back to the dust. Their offspring, according to this teaching, became the evil spirits that roamed the earth. and that men have had to deal with all of these years. And so they have no resurrection. They are simply going to be judged, because the Bible says we will judge the angels one day, which includes principalities, powers, rulers of the darkness of this world, wicked spirits in heavenly places. So these particular spirits, if this rabbinical interpretation 200 years before Christ is correct, then here's what I want to show you. David and his mighty men killed all five giants. They killed Goliath, Lamius, Bibenoph, Saph, and the giant from Gath, wiping out the entire race of the giants on the face of the earth. David killed, and I say it this way, the natural seed of the serpent, but Jesus dealt with the demons and killed the spiritual seed of the enemy. And I think one reason God loved David so much and honored him so much is he was a giant killer, and he was attacking the seed of the serpent. As another interesting point, the Bible tells us in the book of Ruth that Naomi had two daughters-in-law, Ruth and Orpah. You know that Ruth followed Naomi back to Bethlehem, and according to the last chapter of the book of Ruth, Ruth became the great-great-grandmother, and it may be great-great-great, of a boy named King David. But Jewish tradition also tells us that Orpah eventually came to the Promised Land, married a man by the name of Anak, who produced the race of the giants. When David fought Goliath, it was a family feud. And I think that's extremely interesting. In fact, one day I was reading in my Bible about the giants, and Gideon, my God, said, let me look at that. And he went to his Hebrew Bible, and the Hebrew Bible makes it clear about who the mother of the giants were. So the point I wish to make is this, that if David defeated that natural seed of the serpent, and Jesus defeated the spiritual seed of the serpent, then we are aligned with Christ, that the Bible says He has put all things underneath His feet. All things underneath it. Why would all things be underneath His feet? Why didn't it say He's put all things underneath His mouth, His authority of His speaking? He's put all things underneath His mind. He's put all things in the power of His hands. Why did it say He's put all things underneath His feet? Because the prophecy goes back to the seed of the serpent. It'll bruise His head, but thou shalt bruise His heel. So in other words, the victory that Jesus gained is gained through the crucifixion of being on Golgotha's heel and His blood coming into the area as a picture of defeating the powers of Satan. See, there's something interesting about the feet. The feet is what we walk with. We carry the gospel with our feet. Blessed are the feet of those that carry the gospel. With our feet, we dance and we rejoice. I call it dancing on the dragon's head. When we begin to shout and rejoice, we have the enemy underneath our feet. And so when you look at this picture of what the Scripture's teaching us today, something being under your feet represents authority. When Paul wrote to the church at Rome, the Christians were under great persecution. In Romans, the last chapter, he says, "The very God of peace shall bruise Satan under your feet shortly." Under your feet. What did he mean when he wrote that? I did some research and found out something interesting. Again, according to church tradition, the worst emperor in the time of Christianity that ruled up until the time of Paul was Nero. Nero slaughtered Christians. He beheaded Peter, and he also beheaded Paul. He beheaded Paul in the city of Rome. Now, Nero was a schizophrenic. Nero was a very dangerous man. He was a hateful man, a vindictive man. He was a terrible man possessed by evil spirits. But let me say something to you. God said through Paul to the Romans, "The very God of peace will bruise Satan under your feet shortly." What did that mean? You know, according to some research, and I remember, first of all, Dr. E.L. Terry, a friend of mine that's gone to be with the Lord several years ago, Dr. Terry did some research on the subject of what did it mean for the God of peace to bruise Satan under the feet of the Romans. Are you ready for this? Nero's wife, the empress, was said to have converted to Christianity. And Paul wrote a letter and said, "Greet the church in Caesar's house." I mean, right there in the midst of the worst, most corrupt, most perverted emperor that the Christians had to face, Nero, who's slaughtering them in pride, he made slides with razors so that Christians would be slid down and split their bodies in half. He took Christians and put them on crosses and dipped their bodies in oil and lit them up so that the Roman workers could pave a road called the Appian Way. Think about the wickedness of this man. And yet in his own house, God began to raise up people in the house of the adversary and in the house of the enemy. And my word for you today is Satan is cruising for a bruising. And the way that you exercise authority over Satan is, number one, through the power of God's Word. Jesus, when He was tempted, quoted the Scripture, because you can't fight the enemy just with your thoughts. You know why? That's the level he works on. If you try to outthink the enemy, guess what? You'll never do it, but you can always outtalk him. I guarantee you, I can talk faster than the devil can think. If you don't believe that, watch Manifest every now and then, you'll see. And I want to tell you, number one is the spoken Word of God. This is the example that Jesus gave us in Matthew 4, Luke 4. When Satan came against Him, He's quoted the Scripture. And the second thing you have to understand is this: neither give place to the devil. A lot of times we are Christians, but we open doors. It wasn't the devil, it was you. It wasn't somebody else's problem, it was your reaction to it. It was your decision that you made. And by knowing the Word and speaking it, and by closing the door of the enemy, we can actually bruise the enemy. I'm believing God with many of you that have children that are not saved, that this will be the year your kids come to the Lord. I'm believing that some of the folks that have been suffering in their body, that they're going to have a visitation from God and receive a supernatural healing that's going to strengthen them and add more years to their life the way it did old King Hezekiah. But I want you to also understand that Jesus has defeated the seed of the serpent, that Satan's kingdom has been crushed, and Satan is on borrowed time. The reason we're in so many battles, I believe, is because he knows he's running out of time. Got good news for you. You and I aren't running out of time. If we die, we just step into eternity and live forever. It's the devil who's running out of time, according to Revelation chapter 12. So in Gethsemane, where Jesus shed His blood, where the first level of redemption began, was right here in this garden where these ancient olive trees are. And I wanted to bring you a good word. Jesus has conquered the seed of the serpent. Now that's where the amen goes, right there. And the praise God and the hallelujah. Amen? You know, every week on Manifest, we have an offer. I've got one for you. This week, I've got to share with you some places we're coming to, so stay tuned. We'll be right back in just a moment.
See and hear stunning research along with biblical evidence pointing to a subterranean world located under the Earth's crust that houses both fallen angels and the spirits of unredeemed humanity. Perry will share about the scientific discovery of 12 magnetic gates at equal distances in the sea that may indicate the possible entrances to this forbidden world, a world that the souls and spirits of men must avoid at the time of their death. Learn why strange activity is reported in the Bermuda Triangle and other similar locations around the Earth. Something is happening underneath us, and this DVD explains the mystery in detail. This DVD is a great resource tool to reach others for Christ. Perry's new 2-DVD series, Unsealing the Daniel Cipher, and the DVD 12 Gates to Satan's Underworld, are available now for a donation of just $40 or more. Shipping and handling are included. Call toll-free 1-888-21-BREAD. That's 1-888-212-7323, or order online at perrystone.org. You may also send your donation of $40 or more to Perry Stone, P.O. Box 3595, Cleveland, Tennessee, 37320. Request offer DC-113 when writing or calling. This powerful DVD package is available only through the ministry of Perry Stone, and your donation helps keep Manifest on in your area. We look forward to hearing from you today.
You know, oftentimes we will get emails at the end of a month, sometimes hundreds of emails, and they'll ask two questions. What do you have that can help plant a seed in an unsaved family member, maybe to win them to the Lord? Or what is the most recent right now prophetic message that Perry has? Well, this is the one time on Manifest that we've put those two things together. The greatest soul winning message that the Lord ever gave me, and I guess it's different because it kind of approaches the underworld, the chambers of the underworld, kind of from like a little bit of a scientific perspective, you might say, is the 12 gates of the underworld, the magnetic zones that are in the sea being entrances to the underworld. We talk about Bermuda Triangle, Devil's Sea. And look, I know it sounds strange when I just say that, but if you listen to all this teaching, it has really challenged the hearts of a lot of people. We've had people won to the Lord as a result of it. But there's no question that for right now, at this moment, with ISIS in the Middle East, with what's happening in Iraq, what's happening in Persia, what's happening in Israel, in the Gaza, and up into Lebanon as well, This is the message. This is called Unsealing the Daniel Cipher. I went to the book of Daniel. What I did, I took the from chapter 1, we give a big introduction, but chapter 2, all the way into 5, 7, 8, and chapter 9 especially, we did a study on taking all the places where Daniel talked about the time of the end, or a vision or a dream dealt with the time of the end, and we put it all together. And it will help you understand. I believe, for example, that the Antichrist comes out of the Syrian Iraq territory, which is old ancient Babylon. But I don't just say that. We go into this and believe we can prove it, not just 90%, but 100%. I believe it can be proven, especially with what's happening now. It just fits perfectly. I believe this, the foundation of the Antichrist, not the Antichrist appearance, not his coming, but the foundation is now being laid in the country of Syria and Iraq. There's no question in my mind. I've been preaching, you know, I'm 55 years of age, been preaching for 37 years. Never have I seen anything like this. Anyway, please get that. And also, Princeton Pike, Hamilton, Ohio, September 26th to the 28th. All you guys up there, come and join me. Not just guys, I say guys to everybody. No fee to attend. Come to the conference. And please, please go online at peristone.org and check out the main event, October 7th through the 11th, the greatest meeting we have all year long in Pom Pam's Fall Festival right back here. She's going to be cooking in that kitchen for you guys to eat some food, okay? You come and join us in October. God bless you.
Perry Stone invites you to join him for his 2014 Israel tour. The dates are November 24th through December 3rd. Call 1-888-321-3629 or visit perrystone.org for more information and how to register. Seating is limited, so call today.